This graph came across my understanding. It's made by the UN, and what it does is it's highlighting the major economic collapses in the world, and it is associating that or keeping over emphasizing that with the construction of major buildings in the world, and apparently they all coincide. So this kind of understanding was the one that struck something in me in terms of idea of the social space behind the facade. So, and then as I went through looking at it, there were overwhelming volumes of statistics which I'm not going to discuss. Then as I went deeper into the realm of economics as a science, the basic idea of economics being the science behind architecture was something that worried me actually. And then I realized that economics as a science is not the problem. The problem is the way we look at economics. This particular graph is something that everybody, not only economists, but everybody, even architects, is something that they want. It's an exponential graph, and we are particularly living in not so exponential planet. Our planet is cyclic in nature, and this is never ending. It's growth which never ends. This is what we are sold in terms of GDP, in terms of growth, in terms of population, in terms of development, etc. And then I started reading works of economists, and economists also, a lot of economists were with me, and these are some of them which quoted such kind of growth in a different kind of language, and the one that appealed to me the most was this. E.F. Schumacher called this kind of understanding of economics and the world is as meta-economic crisis. It's basically looking at the world, which is in a sense very biodiverse, in very reductionist kind of way. So if the only way you design buildings is, oh, I want it to be tall, I want it to make a statement. There are so many other concerns attached to a building which don't play a role. Then even if a material cannot withstand that much of weight, then you make it withstand that much of weight. So you have simple rules which are existing in a very biodiverse kind of a way. Then I started looking after college for a way to work, and this is what inspired me. Herbs. It's a firm working in homegrown neighborhoods, which is neighborhoods like slums, urban villages, etc. And that's when I questioned a lot of my architectural understanding of practice. Herbs as an organization does very little drawings. These are photos of me working with the local people over there, and we literally made drawings on our hands, on our foreheads and stuff like that. You never expect an architect to do that. Also, the scene in Herbs was when we documented a lot of settlements over there, the question of sustainability, which I'm sure a lot of architects talk about right now, was questioned. You know, these settlements which people look at eyesore, like people see them as eyesores in the city, were actually the modes and models of sustainability. They use local materials, they arrange themselves according to contour, they use space very efficiently. There was no wastage of any sort of labor, and everything was made in a cost-effective way and with use of very little energy. So this was what I thought was sustainable. I would give to Anuradha.
Hi, I'm Anuradha. My journey through ecological realization started with our elective in a fourth year. That was about ecology and architecture. So in that elective, we went through, we went to our native villages and studied the context around and the architecture that was existing and how that architecture was responding to the context. So through that, we saw the diversity in architectural, in architecture itself. So, and then, after completing BArch, I did 1 year ecological societies course from Pune. That made me think more deeper about ecology. That I'll show how. So our first exercise in ecological society was studying life cycle analysis of a products and services that we use in a daily life. For example, a pencil. one pencil, the production of one pencil puts immense amount of impact on the global level. So, and the major thing is we don't even realize that we are impacting on so many things at global level. And we don't even realize that we have only a finite finite resource and not infinite one. So the impacts, if you'll see, are mind-boggling. And the major impact that we came to know through evolution of Earth, and then how in the period of 100 years of industrialization and growing population, the extinction of species, the amount of extinction of a species makes one think that really the lifestyle that we are living, the is it worth living that way? So why not we should why not we should reduce our dependency on a global and go local? And that I related to the architecture also by exploring in architecture how we can reduce that dependency by using local materials and local techniques. And then also in ecological society, we did many site visits about studying various ecosystems around, so that we could understand the sensitivity of a evolution of a species or a biodiversity in a context, particular context. Yes. And then you realize that the biotic component, that is a living component, and abiotic component are completely in a cyclic mode. And today what human lifestyle is doing is going in a linear way and not in a cyclic. So through our practices, not only architecture but also through our by fulfilling our basic needs like food, shelter and clothing also, how we can be sensitive towards context and try to use things which can degrade and go back to nature and not just act as a waste.
Okay.
So that was my major realization about it.
So it's experiences like these which brought us together, and another big binding factor was our native. We both are the ones who came first together along with Vinita Chiragya and Mayu Gosavi. Basically, we belong to the Thane district, which is now in Palghar, and it's divided in Palghar and Thane. And we had one project to do, which was my house in Vajreshwar. It's a small village in Kilton. And but since we had so much of an influence in the student life, we wanted to exhibit that knowledge or that understanding in this house. By then we were not a group, we were just there to make a house. And so Pratik will go through the travel story. We decided to travel throughout our district and come up with various
You heard about our stories. Now the challenge in this particular project is how to, whatever the knowledge we got through by the travel or by the economic study or by the ecological study, how to put that, all the knowledge, it should not go waste when we are doing this project. So me and Shardul decided to travel along this district, and then we chose Thane district. It's our native district, so it is because we are belong to it. So we come across it, and if you see here, the Thane district is mainly divided in the four zones, where the one is the Sahyadri. The yellow part which is you are seeing over here, it is a Sahyadri outcrop, and again then the hillock parts which is in the red, and coastal. So basically, and if you see the typology or settlements over there, it also has an impact of the surrounding, like the topography has a major impact on the lifestyle and architecture of that particular region. And then we come across four villages in that region. From the different typology, and it's five villages. And the first we started with the Murbad because it's my own village, and it's very easy because we are very much close to that particular place. Then the Chinchani, Palsunda, Asangaon, and Keyathan. And if you see that, they all regions are in a different typology. So, yeah.
Hello. What we came across was more than architecture. What we saw was this immense amount of crisis that the whole district was facing. Basically, it's bounded by major industrial zones in the north, which is the Vapi corridor. On the south, of course, there's Mumbai, then there is Nasik, and then there is Badlapur and Kalyan on the east. So, all of the resources for all these zones are going from this region, and this region itself is suffering because of that. So, we had started our search for architectural techniques, but we related all of our architectural techniques to this, and that's where we come. We named this lecture as Pakka Ghar, because what we were observing was the district is very fast changing, and it is getting pakkafied. That's what the people and the developers want to do. But yeah, so this image is again of water shortage. There are people in our district which are living with the amount of water that we get in our flush tanks per day for a family. They basically save one glass every day to have baths at the end of the week. And we are building like this. This is a village structure, okay? None of these photos are from the internet. They are photos from our travel. So, in the same village, there is a structure like this. Or, of course, we are not even talking about the cities yet. Where it is water intensive and it is resource intensive. Whereas this, we found very little amount of water. You know, every day one lady could pick up one bucket and the whole structure would be made with that. So, we found mountains which have been carved out. You know, this particular quarry is in Vajreshwari near Kilton. Now, this quarry produces around 60 trucks of stone. And if you see the village consumption around per day, 60 tons of stone per day, and the consumption of the villages around is, I don't even think it's like half a truck per day, you know. So, we wondered whom this is going for. So, again, the questions come, like there are processing units, the way we process materials. This is the Kachcha processing unit and this is the Pakka processing unit. This is where we have contradicted ourselves, you know, where is the district heading towards. We observed as a practice, construction in the district was a social ritual. A lot of this knowledge, like Anuradha mentioned, came from the elective that we did with Malak sir. The social ritual, and we've been part of these social rituals also. Like this is the Kachcha where the whole family, in fact the whole village comes to celebrate the house as it progresses and participates in it. And this is the Pakka, this is the Mumbai obviously, where you are warded off from the construction site for safety reasons or whatever. Nobody knows what is coming up till the whole building is done. So this is one more area of concern. Now, this is very interesting Varli painting. Our region, half of our region is tribal, and there are Varlis, Mahadev Bhois, Mallar Khoris, Kothakur, Mathakur, etc. This is the idea of a house. Now, when architects are questioned what is a house, this is the only part that we would point out. But if you ask anybody from the district, this whole thing is the house. The backyard, the river, from where the water is coming, from where the mud is coming, the whole supply. So housing essentially is a process rather than a product for these people. It is never complete. If you ask anybody in the village ki to the ghar supply, he will say, no, I still have to do this, I still have to do this. This is not done. This is not yet done. And we've seen houses that have so much potential of being made that you would never imagine this house to be a complete house. So again, there was the Kachcha where, you know, we were surprised by the way certain people live in the village. Like, there were, this is from Palsunda, where the family is living with around three cows, and then they'll chicken, and then there is no living to G+2, G+3. It's not a model. It's according to the person, and we'll highlight this even ahead in our presentation and our documentation. And this is the Pakka. Now, this is basically the person changed his lifestyle, and the structure couldn't cope. and the structure has fallen in ruins, and then we can't even use it for storage. So structures like these triggered a lot of questions. And then of course there are rural aspirations. This house you see is a product of Indira Avas Yojana, which we'll be talking about later, where the person built just this one wall out of pakka materials, and he knew he couldn't get on with it because of money and resource constraints. So the rest of the structure is made with kaccha materials. Again, here this is a kaccha house with a lot of new aspirations coming by, and this is this person is Nanda Kumar, is living in our village, is cut off from the rest of the village and doesn't want any relationship with the village around. So what are we actually doing with our materials does matter. So while designing the structure, this was the challenge which we took upon, where we were looking at a lot of